Turn to Ban. Dire Team Ban. Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Fanatics, turn to pick.
Vengeful spirit.
Dire Team pick.
Welcome back. Game number three here in a best of three. We've gone the distance to game number three, TNC against Fnatic. I'm Gareth in the JD Studios, and honestly, it's been fun chatting to you guys about Southeast Asia, Brunei, Jakarta, places I used to live, bringing back memories, my childhood, and all the lovely food. Well, but we have a game pass, and we have a draft to talk about. Scant against Fnatic. This is one of TNC's best chances to get themselves to European LAN, or the world. They really are.
Yeah, absolutely. And if they were to win this match, the finals would be against teams that they've done pretty well against historically, I think. I don't think they've been that challenged in the Philippines region, except I mean SK and done well against MVP. So this game is very, very big for them. It's interesting, by the way, I was talking in the previous game about how Fnatic just banned Dra and Doom in the first phase every single time against TNC in the last few days. And there's a sense in which, even though maybe those are the best bans against them, for AU, when you're a drafter and you know your opponent's going to ban these two heroes in the first two, remaining. Gives you some kind of leeway to adjust your bans. And what I've seen TNC doing over and over is they're usually banning Invoker, between Invoker and Shadbat, they're usually banning two of the three. And they try and pick the third, and I feel like they've been least successful when they give away the Invoker because they don't want to pick it as much, they're not as happy to play it.
Yeah.
So last game they banned the Invoker and the Chargers, this game they banned the Invoker and then Chargers they take the bath.
Do wonder though it'll maybe look to switch things up, but I know that Raven plays OD safe lane a fair amount. One. But where have they been playing Batrider recently? Is it damage off lane or has that been...
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be Sam playing the Batrider. Yesterday against MVP, Sam had a game on Batrider where they shut him down so hard, he was literally level 1 in like 6 minutes. He had got 0 XP. And then, like, in the space of the next 3 or 4 minutes, he like, got his entire level 7 blink dagger and then just, like, was catching people left, right, and center. And his game ended up being almost as good as the next game was, last game. Beginning of the game was like, MVP did something very clever. You know, in the off lane is like that big camp, and at worst case, you think back and go stack that. They didn't block the camp, but they put forward at the beginning of the game. So they would just see him when he was there stacking and stuff, and they'd just use it to make ganks all the time. Like, push him out, kill him. I don't know, maybe Fnatic were watching that. Got a plan to deal with the bath in a similar way. I mean, Fnatic had the first pick here, right? And they chose the Venge, full well knowing that the bath be taken, and at least then they've got the counter to it preemptively.
Dire Team Stuff. Ban.
You don't want the hands Fnatic getting onto that one. And net hero pool for the past couple of days, they actually moved away from too much other than Sven and Spectre. I mean, he played a bit of Gyrocopter here and there, but it seems to be that kind of three hero rotation. I don't know if you've seen him play anything else.
I haven't really, to be honest, in those three, so I'd expect them to want to secure the Sven round now, if that's what they want to go for, but I don't know if Sven is the best pick at this stage in the draft. Like, Bat obviously works really well against Sven, OD can be good against Sven too. It's nice that Sven naturally buys BKB again, that's always good against OD, but OD still just being able to astral people,
Dire Team
Lone Druid, which I mean, Ohio definitely can play Lone Druid. So that's not clear that it would be a net here. And honestly, for a player who's typically a support player who had some experience in the past playing carry, but he's mostly a support player, Lone Druid's quite a specialized carry hero. So don't know if I'd expect them to give it to net. I'm not sure. I mean, like, if he, like, you know, it's either he knows the hero or he doesn't, kind of thing.
10 seconds remaining.
Let's also maybe limit and see if they want to go for a spend themselves and maybe block pick it from Fnatic. They maybe wouldn't like to against the Lone Druid, Venge, and Puck. A little bit of added risk there against the Entangle from the Lone Druid, definitely. And they'll go back for the Lich, which they tried in game
Fnatic's
one.
Turn to pick.
Adds even more lane presence, stops the Lone Druid from getting that fast Midas. You get the sacrifice out. Where AU is going to be running it though. Go back to the gyrocopter for net.
Dire team ban.
Good control in the mid game between Puck and Gyro, and again Ohio having the greedier free roll and trying to farm himself up on that and maybe carry from the offlane.
I've seen TNC Lich with Doom, seconds, but obviously they can't get Doom against Fnatic ever. And otherwise, I've seen them mostly picking Lich or mid dual lanes. I've seen that once or twice actually in the last week. Again, one of the games where they beat MVP yesterday, where they did the spec dual lane mid. It's something that could really be frustrating for enemy mid to deal with, because mid players are the kind of player. I mean, look, put it this way. All of the ways that are easy for you to, like, fissure block mid lane, pull to ancients, those kind of things, Valve keep patching those things.
Fnatic's
they understand how, like, powerful it is to be able to deny XP to mid laners, so you have Lich, which is just like, it's part of the deal. That's just what Lich does. I think it's an option for them to run in the mid lane. I think the Batrider doesn't necessarily need Lich with it,
remaining.
And it's definitely not really the kind of support that you put at the safe lane ever.
5 seconds remaining.
Both Spirit, don't want Jay around on that one and reserve making your deep life a living hell. But TNC still need that one role hero for Raven. And he is definitely a guy that has quite a few options here. Ember Spirit might be something you look to ban out, but it's going to be the Alchemist.
Dire team pick.
Oh, I don't know if they've... It's had a resurgence, honestly. Safe lane Alchemist is still going for like the Armlet Sand and the Asher build and stuff like that. But
Fnatic's
like I said, Raven's Ember Spirit, I kind of called it in game number two, that is one of his heroes. When he first joined TNC, he was playing Ember Spirit over and over again. When he took the mid lane from TE, then when he switched back to safe lane, this hero is one of his cores, and out here for game three to just win with it, definitely a show of dominance. Sticking it to Fnatic.
It's quite, it just makes me think though, Ember Spirit can kill Puck, right, if you get those chains.
Remaining.
I still feel like we could be seeing an Ember and Lich mid. I mean, I'm not sure if they'd mix up who plays it.
Reserve time.
One man shield Ember towards the mid and have Raven on the OD. That could work. I'm liking that more now I think about it.
It's possible they could still play Raven on the Ember and Teehee on the OD. I'd never seen this before, but yesterday there was a game where Teehee went to the safe lane on his Klinks. So, then again, I wasn't too thrilled about Teehee's OD recently. Yeah, so okay, so Raven's gonna be playing the OD, and I think it might be a better fit. I think Teehee just feels very comfortable on these like in and out maneuverable agility carry heroes, which fight and also scale. I just think that's his.
Like the guerrilla warfare as well, jumping in and out of fight. Sure that. So one of his strengths that we often talk about offlaners in is the fact that he doesn't die a lot, right? He gets kills and he always puts in a position where he's able to get these kills. But he's always aware of the threat of the opponents and he very rarely puts himself in a position where he's just dead to right just to get a kill. The last game we saw him blinking forward, but he always had like the save him out, Astral Imprisonment to get him through, and that BKB. The Ember Spirit, these remnants, they have to stop. We know the stance out from Puck one, and I think Dashen is kind of in reaction to Ember, is just face him down, Carapace the Flame Guard, get the stun initially there, and lock him in position. The rest of Fnatic, the damage output. And see. Raven OD heading towards the safe lane. Sam H, Brown Boots first on the Batrider to go down towards bottom. E, four man shield, Ember. Already got some good wards up over towards the Radiant Ancients here, and they're all being pinged out actually by Fnatic. They know that this has happened. Where the Lone Druid is heading and blocked up, yeah. Ward up to the side. Doesn't know exactly about that one though. There are no sentries being brought out here.
I like this observer cliff ward. This is the same one MVP actually used against TNC when they were dire against TNC's Radiant yesterday. And it ended up making them, creating a lot of value for them, giving them a couple of kills on the supports and on the offlaner. I also really just like this Lich against the mid laner thing when TNC play against Fnatic. I feel like there's some recognition here, which is that if we talked about TE for a year that he would just win every mid matchup no matter what, and he hasn't done that against mid one. Like, that's just a fact. He's every time I've seen him go 1v1 against mid one, he's almost always been outfarmed. He's almost always been losing those lanes. And I mean, I don't know that that's necessarily why they picked the Lich, but I feel like it's something he might be mindful of. And you're not gonna have the situation where you have your mid players used to just outplaying their opponent, like suddenly being turned around on. If you put a Lich with them, pretty much guarantees they're gonna have a good time.
Ohio, not dragged away back. Astral is there from Raven. Oh. You always used to ask what's the counter to this lone druid stacking and pulling wave across, and well, there's an easy answer. OD has some prism. Hold it out for a little bit there, I'll hold the creep wave as well. One melee creep missing though. We've a little bit of a deficit here, so Raven has to get these hits in and auto-attack the wave a little bit to hold Duke up where he wants it exactly.
Oh,
back,
Sam.
Back tier 1. Is, damn. Spot of bother. 5. I just there, just chain stunned up, I guess.
Chain stun, nearly killed, and this is still a better start than his bat rally yesterday, because he has got 41 points of experience in the first minutes.
Congratulations, Sam. Done it, you've made it. See, he dove himself up, and you still see this Puck farming very well, 3-1 so far, while the Ember Spirit maybe going to struggle a little bit under this tower, and right quick attacks from one is not the friendliest of situations. AU just very heavily on harassing and blasting back the Puck for now, but salve that's forced out of him.
This is interesting. Yesterday, I believe, AU actually went twice into ice armor, and then he was just like spamming ice armor to protect from harassment, deciding to actually harass back. I think that they want to be able to kill, like I was saying before. I think because of the power of Searing Chains against Puck, they want to have the possibility of catching him out and killing him here.
Well, I was going through it. So far, actually. Down, but it's the OD that has the 12 for 6. Oh well, Savage's Batrider stacks up his camp. They didn't sentry it up, so he's that available for himself to farm through with Apalm and Firefly. It feels like DMC should be getting more value out of this middle lane. Puck is still getting plenty of levels, plenty of last hits, while Teehee is throwing a tiny amount, even with a sacrifice, just to hold this lane. Farm going. Without any rotation, DJ or 3-3. Are they going in with a Searing Chains? Fairy Fires are there. Mid one, he's baiting it out, he's gonna get the first blood!
And this is just like exactly what I was talking, like, despite the fact that they're 2v1ing and mid one still finds a way to outplay them, and let's be fair, this is, Teehee doesn't want to dive him at the tower, like, maybe not necessary to dive him under the tower. He's got a haste rune, he figures, even if he face shifts, I'll get the chain off, but then there's the orb as well, and I mean, mid one is just the king of these slippery, sneaky players, and when you're playing Puck, You don't need the magic, you don't need the verify, your hero's just like built to make those players.
Now he's got the full bottle as well. He go back for the chapter boss. One, wait, what's the net worth discrepancy? 300 for mid one ahead of Teehee. Is that a bottle bought by AU? Yeah. I was sitting here wondering, hang on a second, this can't be right. How does Teehee have so much money on top of his bottle, but it's the Lich buying a bottle for him?
That is committed Lich play. That is like, this is what Lich picks are about, by the way. Like, anyone who's not sure when to pick a Lich, when not to pick a Lich. Sometimes you see Lich pick to like counter Enigma Black Hole or something to have that chain frost, but most of the time it's like, Lich is there to be like that sort of PPD position, 7 position support. Your entire purpose in the game is to like try and help usually just one of your particular lanes or teammates in every way you can, and buying them a bottle is just kind of a natural extension, I think.
Really cute play, and it barely doesn't work out. AU actually brought the courier over to stack the medium camp to give vision over dire side to stack both camps at the same time. Missed out on the large camp though, unfortunately for him. Oh, intelligent stuff from him. And I've not seen this too many times, you know, support flying bottles, it's always kind of been found and theorycrafted. First time I really saw it was a South American game where Chen bought bottle level 1 for his mid-hero. I think it was an Ember in that game as well. And it's just one of those things where, you know, if you have a Chen or a Lich and they don't need items at level 1, jungling or they're just going to be sitting back sacrificing people or stacking and pulling, then it's perfectly fine to just tap. Play.
Hey. The other
Firefly on bottom, fly over the cliffs and he won't thunder.
The other thing with the bottle situation is just that it was the Lich who got the kill, right? Because Puck killed Ember and then Lich killed Puck and then pretty he was like, hey, I've got all this gold, like how do we turn this around? And in that sense, like, it might be that he wasn't even planning it in advance, and then it was just like pretty clever thing to notice. His lane's not going as well as we want, but our Lich has a whole lot of gold. I know, I'll buy you a bottle.
Are you a bottle? First tower goes down though, 5 minutes in. Even without a hardcore pushing lineup, that tier 1 drops very fast here for Fnatic. Get a lot of gold in the bank for their support, as 343 can soon order boots and DJ. Still get his arcanes, but Lone Druid up towards top has been forced out. The Dying Talon now focus time to try and get that hand of Midas as quick as he can. Raven to just free farm away up here. Mid 1 is having such a spectacular game, 17 and 10. There's 10 denies, you know, he's limiting the level 6 timing here of the Ember Spirit. He's already got level 6 and a half himself. While AU's Lich, where he's been stacking and controlling these camps up and actually getting it over to the Bat Rider, I believe. Yeah, Teehee. We're going to be taking advantage of these stacks. It's all going to be going towards Samich's Bat to get that faster level, blink a little bit quicker as well, because he's stuck level 3. Bat is having a rough time.
Yeah, and you know, also level 3, the support Nyx on the enemy team, and this is something we didn't get to discuss much in the draft, but I think support Nyx is a very greedy pick. It's often a pick that teams get punished for, ends up not contributing that much, but if the Nyx gets to level 6 and it hasn't cost your team anything, that like one of your supports was a Nyx for the first 6 levels, it's actually like a ridiculously strong pick, especially in this matchup. There's a lot of work for DJ to do on the Nyx. I think that that's something that could cause TNT a lot of trouble, actually, if this Nyx just gets up to 6 and they've not gained anything special from the laning stage for the enemy team having a support.
That needs to kill more creep, I think, here is the moral of the story. 5 last hits, the Nyx has 12, kind of all tying into what you're saying about the Nyx level 4 and moving into that. If he can, while Teehee, he runs forward. Look at his full health here with 5-6 charges as well. Maybe he even looks to turn around on the Teehee with a Beanpole. Oh, jumps away just as the Wailing Rift comes out. The level 3 Wailing Rift as well from the puck, so Teehee was most likely dead there. Able to get that jump.
He did have a pretty big magic one, but put it puck, so I think he probably would have died. Close call there. We've got to remember this. I mean, this Fnatic draft is very much, I think Ohio's Lone Druid is meant to be an Admiral Bulldog Lone Druid. Yeah, it's meant to be the actual carry, the later things go. I don't think that's what's different to the last draft. Like, Nets Gyro again, but this is not the everything about Gyro game. It's all meant to be about the Lone Druid. So, the fact that he's kind of managing to find his farm now, that's very important. And again, there's like the Gyro and also the Nyx and the pack to be able to make a lot of space for that. The mid game begins.
Dealing with a Lone Druid though. I mean, that was Devourer with Lone Druid, so with that Arcane Orb to do a lot of damage back as I get a little bit of lag coming through, but it should be fine. Sam H! Got his level 3 and he's finally gonna try and take out this stack at long last. Gold Lodge Camp, Firefly with a 6 stacks of stick farm and AU. He's got Ice Armor, but he's not throwing it out just yet onto anyone. Experience over to the Lich and the Witch Doctor as well, it looks like, sharing it as well, which is kind of interesting. Would have thought that Sam H would love to have level 6 as soon as he can, while QQ down towards bottom lane. So he'll get his XP down at bottom, get himself into level 6, actually looks like faster than the Bat Rider is. Your Witch Doctor is outstripping your Bat in terms of experience here.
He actually like inefficiently cleared the stack as well, that's why the creeps didn't all die. Because he didn't have a napalm left over, so the stacks actually ran out. Like, you meant to always keep napalms up, so there were 6 stacks, and then at some point there was just 0 again. Dire's top tower
is under attack. For him. The next Radiant's assassin, the Vendetta, is up on this level 6. He's gonna go around hunting, maybe looking for the Batrider who's no longer farming in the jungle just now. Sam H.
Gonna steal the center.
Bottom lane. Good if he wanted to. See he. Cross. I don't know if I'm opening for DJ to move in because mid one as well as net, they are running themselves across to the east, but see he. Feeling his spidey senses tingling. There's the little jump and stunt. Okay there, there's no further aggression from taking mid one. Taking control over this dire jungle and making sure that stacks, if they are being built up, just cannot be taken by anybody.
Very early smoke from TNC. Big.
Jump in. Draw sends Teehee back. Call onto QQ and Raven actually trapping him in place. So Teehee now entangled up. Jump himself back onto a Remnant.
Okay. He's aggressively moving into Ohio.
They actually do a lot of damage back onto Lone Druid, but the Sanity Eclipse not going to hit onto anybody as the stun comes through to Teehee. And Astral's Eventual Spirit holds him out of a salve onto Ohio, keeps him alive. They need another slight and chains, but there's no slight, it's only chains. There's nothing to catch, there's nothing to jump, but 343, the Eventual Spirit pretty much just done for there. Radiant's finally catch up with the lag.
You cast. He had exactly 220 mana, and then he frost armored, and he couldn't chain frost. I just happened to be looking at the lich at the start of the fight. Don't know, maybe they could have got more kills if they threw out. Chain frost is worth more than the single frost armor.
About to reconnect. Looks like that's fixed the lag for now. Get back. Knowing little spikes that we don't usually get from Southeast Asian games. It's usually reserved just for Chinese servers. But again, the Midas is done for Ohio and then it's taking down his tier 1 systematically. There's no blink daggers yet, but with the cast forward. Draw over to Ohio, he's still caught a little bit with an astral. Searing chains that filled up the spirit bear in Ohio is going to get caught here. The recoil is good back on the fall, the cooldown as well. Net comes through with the damage up and the stamina is taken out. Teehee needs to run it back, but he doesn't. How if he does? Oh, yes, he does. Raven still aggressively on the hunt and he takes one out. With the help of that chain frost, they burn through four here. Fnatic on their own tier one ramp. Absolutely demolished by TNC.
Chain Frost is like a completely ridiculous spell in a situation where it can keep bouncing. It's often underestimated just because people take for granted that a Chain Frost won't bounce a whole lot. Most situations in a game, especially early on when it's not like pulled with some kind of AoE control. But I think I got 4 or 5 bounces there, which is just like huge damage output from your Lich, which again, this hero is like meant to just be there as like the person who denies creeps and buys the bottle for the Ember Spirit, it's like that it can produce that kind of value, the damage output, that's something like a Zeus would. That's fight winning stuff, obviously.
Now Raven has got a ton of money. Fortunately for Fnatic, Puck has finished off Link's dagger. Outworld Devourer has one of his own from the safe lane while Ember Spirit boots a Traveler up. Dire's middle tower. Early lead that mid one has gained for himself. Hot right now, but it's still the Ohio show at this point, and they're going to peek up the front saving because Teehee forward gains, but Jay got his nice little mix of stats near the cast and bounce between them, but the death ward down. Look at the damage output on the DJ. Ohio's already dropped in a great convergence of skills and players. That one location allows TNT to catch the number. Forward, QQ. This is one just trying to take down the little witch doctor, but is it enough damage? Scan? No, it's not. QQ just TP's himself back to Fountain. On that expenditure from Fnatic doesn't pay off a single bit.
So, we see a fight at the mid lane where the Chain Frost catches close to each other, and now we see the same thing but with the paralyzing Karsk. And in a weird way, the Karsk is almost more effective sometimes than the Chain Frost, because once you catch two people on their own with the Karsk, they're stuck in it pretty much till the end of the Karsk. The Chain Frost you can like gradually pull away from each other and take two shots each. But both of them are kind of like things that like they're both pretty good against a hero like Lone Druid, which is usually me grouped with the Spirit Bear, and they're both things that punish the kind of two man group ups, which quite well against the Nyx when it's trying to find for a kill like that.
Eat plenty of money. MH for that blink map initiation. All grouped up down here. Maybe they'll walk into Ohio, or maybe Ohio will walk into them. Places award. Three has doesn't. Just leave them over to the side. AU walk up onto high ground here, but do they think he's alone? They're just like chains. EJ, the sentry drop, Lasso, cancel out by the cavern as well. But Dreamfall on mid one, doesn't catch up to anyone now, just gonna get blasted down. Jumps himself back up to high ground, but it's Amber Raven just waiting patiently for him up on top of that ramp while the chase is on. QQ with TE looking for 3-4-3. The Glimmer Cave, nope, doesn't have it. Just TP's himself out. Have a draw. Gonna be enough.
That is an uncharacteristic mistake from mid one there. I don't know if it makes a huge difference in the bigger picture in terms of who's gonna win that fight. I think what's happening here is this is like Approach is go high on the lone druid and make him like that bulldog kinda. He's actually the carry even though he's from the offlane. Fnatic in a strange position. Like they've deliberately done it because they, you know, wanted to adapt and that's the way they thought they'd play against TNC this game. They're used to having Ohio making these like fight winning plays early on in the game and can't fall. He's getting caught.
And he's dead again.
He's gonna spawn and have another 20 seconds before he can summon a Spirit Bear. And it's just like a lot of these early fights, I feel like Fnatic are just used to being in a position where it's easy for them to take them. It's a bit more difficult when you're running the lone druid because it's a hero that just doesn't do that much in those situations.
Really, you're looking at Fnatic's lineup here and they want to fight as four, the Nyx, Venge, Huck and Gyro. They want to go and fight. They want to go and push in, use their ultimates and kill people, destroy them. While the lone druid is off AFK farming. And every time they do this, you can see they've always found a way to smoke up or just melt into a position where they find the lone druid alone. Kill them off. So this Radiant's timing, honestly, after three deaths, is going to be incredibly slow. This was a quick Midas after a quick Iron Talon, and the Lone Druid probably should have had his relic at 60, 70 minutes, then, you know, a 20 minute Radiance kind of thing. The deal he's got now is try and get Radiance as quick as he can by, you know, 22, 23 minutes. If that's even possible anymore. Getting so delayed that do you stay away from the Radiance, or is that so inherently why you pick Lone Druid that it's not an option? You kind of pigeonhole yourself into a position where you have to, so you have to.
I mean, there was a time where Maelstrom was pretty popular as the rush. I think it's something he could be forced into. I don't think we're at that point yet. I think the plan will still be the Radiance. But I do think Fnatic needs to get some more kills on the board sometime soon. They need to either get a few important pickoffs or they need to win one of these fights. And they certainly still do have the tools for it. Got, you know, if they get a good initiation with catching maybe two people or catching one or two people, the Gyro with a big cooldown, something like that, can do it. But at the same time, TNC have some pretty easy tools for winning fights as well. Like, Ember Spirit, if you're not controlling him, can just be slippery. You can be spamming spells and you're pulling in and out all the time. You have to consider the chain frost because you've already lost a fight, so you've got to consider the cast, you've already lost a fight that. OD is actually very, very farmed at this stage of the game, and there's the belt that can pick you off, so I feel like every hero on TNC presents some kind of threat. Fnatic, while they've got the tools to win these fights, they really need them to be starting on their own terms. They really need to like have, in a sense, it's a lot to do with vision. They need to have like a vision advantage moving into the beginning of a skirmish. Never refuse gold given.
Peace towards this mid and smoke up themselves. DJ and 343, these are three heroes that kind of want to fight with mid one, and they're going to make the sweep down towards the bottom tier two. Flying over to the side, and it's a natural thing to come and TP at the bottom tier 2 when it's pushed in, just experience for a support, maybe try and farm a little bit, and it's going to be.
He just got a blink.
Flame. No flame guard up. Blink forward, silence, the him. Well, jump there by Fnatic. Smoke pays off, and they'll look for the tier 2 as well, but this is where TNC maybe want to try and retribution. Across, but the Radiant Observer Ward is already up, scouting out every single movement here from TNC, and the smoke is going to be spotted. Fnatic knows this is happening, they'll back themselves away. Do not want to be caught by the initiation here, Batrider, at all.
I feel like this Fnatic got to know that. Sorry, TNC have got to know there's a ward. The reaction is so immediate, yeah, and we see the ping, but the spot where they're pinging is not what is.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Sentried up on the high ground, the clear above Roshan, with Amage caught, mid one jumps forward. Astral there to save up, down to Batrider, but try and snap back. The coil is broken, Raven. himself away in his homing missiles. I need to take this one out in case there are any further jumps forward as... TP! Fleets from AU as he barely scraped himself away from that one. Well, up the top lane. Ping out. Ohio, get yourself out of here. Dangerous spot up at top. Farming into your Radiance. 1,000 gold saved up now, and his timing isn't looking that bad anymore.
Yeah, it's a very good change of momentum, Fnatic. And it's again to do with the war. Okay, they're jumping in on AU, and that's gonna be a nice, easy kill for them. It's again to, like, they get the pickoff, they get the important ward, and then with that vision, they're able to waste a lot of time from TN while they learn Druid is farming. Mid one is buying a veil. Anything of that, I mean, we've seen Veil on a lot of heroes recently that didn't buy it before, but is not one that I've seen.
This is another mid one thing.
He does tuck Veil?
Yep. Seen him do it. I don't know if it's always, because he rarely plays Puck. Like you said, it's mainly Invoker, and when he doesn't play Invoker, he plays Zeus. At least from the games that I've seen. I've seen him play Puck. This is the third time I've caught it, and I think this is the second time I've seen him go blink into Veil. But it's just mid one things.
Alright. It's a good stat item. It's nice to have the regen actually of the helm, so you've got something to keep you sustained outside. And
he likes going Dagon as well instead of Yule's third item, by the way.
Alright, so that's very popular all around the world recently, for Paxty going Dagon again now, so it got a lot of spell damage, to be honest. I mean, it's like Veil is really good with Gyrocopter. It's like, it's such a weird thing. It's like, you never see a Gyro by a Veil, but it's actually really nice to have a Veil when you have a Gyro on your team.
Nothing. Got their SNY here for Nat, but they just want to go and brawl and fight a little bit more. Again, buying time. Can for Ohio. Get that relic, is time well spent. QQ's jumped on. Asuka's bouncing annoyingly back on the net though, and DJ's gonna throw the Vendetta out, but he's healed up. Now burnt down by mid one jump again. Little things. Kills that they need. 7-11 to score on the doors. That rider. Ballsy farming. The Sappy Ringer Dream Call can't stand mage, but there's the Astral to save him through. The orb is there as well, but the slight misses. All down from net. The Chain Frost gonna bounce back onto Fnatic though, and now 3-4-3. The risk goes down. Returning to the front line. The Gyrocopter back. The Eclipse is not gonna do enough damage to kill off net. Gyrocopter is retreating. Astral does he bloody well can, but I think he's got his number. He's just caught. Yep, slight chain. Batrider. Astral's onto mid one as well. The Corpus bloody tug as well. Oh, he's gonna try and open himself away. Net slammed. One more hit is all they need with the slight chains there. He will catch it. But fuck. The higher ground. Damage with the AU. They secure that kill while DJ, Nyx Assassin, still back in the trees.
Interesting, because I think TNC had gotten a bit sloppy. Fnatic were doing really well and getting pickoff after pickoff, and Fnatic maybe just get a bit too carried away, get a bit too. Like, the reason these pickoffs have been working is precisely because of that, because they were pickoffs. Once you go that close to the enemy base, it stops being a pickoff and it starts being like you're asking for a fight. It comes as a fight again, and TNC show, well, hang on, we're still kind of in a pretty commanding position when it comes to taking fights when all our heroes are around.
The 21 minutes. Travels Battle Fury for a mid-Ember Spirit. Superb timing, honestly, for TE. And now he can keep the split push going as long as he doesn't get caught by the Nyx Assassin. Just make sure that you don't get Catalyst through the Flame Guard while the rest of his team takes down Roshan. Edge up on the high ground, just gonna give this flying vision across to make sure that there's no one sneaking here. Got the relic on the bear at long last, and Ohio, he's made great strides. Filled into that relic.
Oh, we must remember that AU basically donated 700 gold to his progression in this game. So
that's true.
It does put him slightly further forward. But it's still, because he was first blood, he wasn't doing that well forgetting. And I do think he's doing very, very well now. He's at worth. Ember and Odie, pretty scary looking though. Odie's gonna get to BKB soon, and all of a sudden, what do? The BKB Odie. I just think you run. That's what is there. Maybe once the Blind Druid's very farmed. He's, speaking of which, he's not too far from his Radiance.
Ohio's done an amazing job at not dying. Attack. 10 minutes in, he was 0-3, and he's still 0-3. They denied the tower up at top, but yeah, Ohio hasn't died in, I want to say, a good 8 minutes. Yeah, pretty amazing, so.
So the game plan is still on for Fnatic in that sense. Like, Thundred is not too far from where he needs to be. He's quite where they'd like him to be. You know, they want him to be the top net worth roundabout when he hits his Radiance. He'll have to do some farming back in to get to that point, but it really just takes like one compelling fight and then push power, take objectives with that. See the Lone Red launch itself up to the top, or even the Gyrocopter potentially.
Adam, 4-3 with only Tranquil Boots, 1500 net worth. Flitch got earned Tranquil's Magic Wand. Dagger out from Teehee. Need the mobility a fair amount against this lineup, definitely. He doesn't go for, you know, Manta style or something like that to get out of the stances and playing disables from Fnatic, projectile, dodge, stun, some Venge, things like that. Point is just map control. One, you jump on top with the help of DJ. They've got lane wards here, Fnatic do. One off guard, but Radiant's TNC, they're having none of this. He's mid pushing tier 1, the rest of the team kind of wandering aimlessly around this tier 2 behind him. This is one of the weirder movements. They're just waiting for a smoke? Yeah.
Yep. There's wards at the top lane in the position of Fnatic. This is like a really clever way to fight against the Ember Spirits, I think. You'll see him TP into lane early before your creeps even see their creeps, and you'll always be like, these two can kill him. And unfortunately, because of the smoke gank from TNC, I don't think the T is going to go there anytime soon, and everyone will be like wondering, should I not just be like pushing this wave right now? Like, if he knew, he would have been pushing the wave.
Good swap from 3-4-3, but that chain shot bounce back into him. Mid one wants to go back into the day. He heals himself up. Big charge from the end is there as well. He's still not dead. The Radiant's burn was sticking him over, but the Astral on there. Oh, now he's gone. And the burn will secure the kill while over on the side. He wants to jump back in. This one, the corner. That's what the key jumps down. Makes that comes there. Burns through Ness Manor, and now he's HP as well. Raven shreds through them. The low to the Barry's is alive, though. Popping down to these TNC heroes as the Aegis pops back. He's gonna jump himself back. No, jump himself forward, then back. Of course, the aggressive play comes before the defensive one. A QQ still being ravaged. The Marauding Bear, but a good two-man change there with the Astral down as well. Ohio. And himself back. Teehee again jumping forward and remnanting back. Aggressive into defensive. And TNC, they're running them rampant here. Back and forth. Fnatic. Do with themselves. Under attack.
Actually, maybe a minor win for Fnatic just because, I mean, it's 2-for-2 plus. They got rid of the Aegis. That's. I don't know, TNC should be happy with that. I'm a lot happier with the way Raven's using the ulti this game than the way Teehee was using it last game. You see, he almost every fight he hits once or twice and then just immediately throws it out. Done with, burn the mana, do the duke, and you know, see from there. The reason that the fight doesn't go that badly for Fnatic is because of 3-4-3 swap at the beginning. I think it's the first time in this game he's been able to swap to counter the bat's ulti. It's difficult to do when you're such a hard, like, 5 position support Venge. Remember, they're running the Nyx with it, so he's got, like, no levels on the Venge, he's got no farm in the Venge, and he's in the right position to stop the baddie. Well, speaking of the baddie, he's not going to be in the right position for this one.
The Dream Ball doesn't land either. DJ thought he had the safety of his mate behind him. One, a little bit off the mark here with this puck. 4-4-4, definitely not the tempo control you kind of wanted here.
He had a great lane stage. I mean, against the dual lane, he was winning that lane pretty much. He had a few ulti whiffs since then.
Got your net BKB though over the Gyrocopter. Fighting can't continue here, maybe, for Fnatic. Found himself in a position where they can actually accomplish that. Io still moving into the Vlad, but the rest of his team does have to go and brawl 4v5 for another, you know, 5-10 minutes or so. TNC from the high ground, but.
He's going BKB also, I think. I mean, he could be going Desolator or Maelstrom, but I'm pretty sure he's going BKB with that hammer.
Yeah, I think you need a defensive item here.
Yeah, I think it's the right choice, to be honest. The same as I said about the Urge, like, he has a BKB, he can't dine a fight, he can, the way he's been wanting to play, by going quite deep, getting as many slides off, like just burning people with that tank guard. You can do that with a BKB, absolutely.
Nothing, though. Burn through with a counter, damage out, but forced out back, not enough to keep here alive. Now mid one, the Dream Claw, not gonna miss on this damage, trying to keep out, but he's still stunned up, and they jump forward again onto AU. The Chain Frost bounces back between them, but it's 3 dead for TNC with nothing in return. And that was a power. He's himself the heck away from there.
It's a really nice initiation from DJ. Reminds me a bit of the Sam H initiations from last game. This assassin really, I did mention earlier, if you run a support next and manages to end up just being an extra core, that's a lot of value. The small cost is that your Venge is a lot weaker, a lot slower, takes longer to get level 11, harder to cancel the bat ulti, but when your Nyx is giving you those initiations, it's well worth it.
All happens so quickly as well with DJ. Four staff depleted.
Dire's structures are
they'll lose this tier 2 tower, they glyph it as they're going to defend it. With Ember alive in 10 seconds, maybe they have enough time to run themselves across here. They need to start fighting soon though. Keep moving themselves. Tier 2's already gone. What's the last out of tower, so maybe glyph was worth it. Really, glyph and pretty go forward to try and defend it. That was just more delaying tactics here, but it's not a delay. Fnatic from moving themselves through the jungle and keeping this Bermuda Triangle of wards going. I mean, look at that. It's all across. All the movement through of TNC. Might have moved themselves over towards the ancients, wards over this direction, but aren't any.
Feel a bit bad for them. I mean, those two wards in the lane at the top were, I think, a very clever way to try and kill Ember Spirits, and somehow, since they put those wards up, he just hasn't been there, like, ever. It's a normal place to expect them to go. If they'd done the same approach on the other side of the map, they would have caught him already once or twice because he's been there more.
I'm waiting to see mid one actually move past this veil into anything really. Well,
man.
Well, what are you going for?
The gem, right? Mid one actually paid for the gem.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. Doesn't show that it's owned by someone else, so. So that was just like they wanted it right then. You know, we want to be aggressive, take control of the map right now, and Ben probably no one else could afford it.
Blends out, but five heroes here for Fnatic up on the top lane. Hero Bear still shoving bottom with the Radiant and the Vlads. He can't really do too much about that. Raven. BKB here to kill off 343. They're looking for something else. Sam H to jump forward. There's the two man Silence and Coil, and this is not looking good for TNC. They've lost their two big heroes. Where's Ember Spirit? Comes in now, trying to clean through Nebu, stuns up the canvas, and now the slide back. It's just not enough. Jeez. 12 away, but TNC just lost everybody with that one movement forward. They caught a kill, they wanted more. But mid one, perfect counter initiation.
You know what, I don't know if you caught the start, I think Fnatic initiated, and I think there's something psychological that, like, the Venge swapped the OD in. And Raven was just really quick. He immediately BKB'd and they started Venge. And I think when that happens, when the enemy team fails the initiation, it gives you this confidence to like push forward and kill more people. Because it was only the Venge swap that they did. It was maybe the wrong thinking from TNC to be like, we used the BKB and OD to deal with the Venge swap. Okay, now we can chase for more. I just think there's like a mental thing to that. When the enemy team tries to go on you, you turn it around on them. You always feel this kind of like, oh, let's just go at them more. Really wasn't the right call there.
Or maybe it's more of, we use BKB, we have to go forward. Like, I want to use this BKB for someone more than just Ben. Forward, yeah. And Teehee, this silence is going to last long enough for the damage to come out, the Dream Coil, but stop away from the Remnant, but look at DJ waiting on top of the Remnant ready for him, but not ready enough to kill him. How escapes?
Very close stuff. Teehee getting close to his BKB now. Raven also, when he died early in the top fight, was his first death of the game, so would have given a big streak. He could have also gotten out as well, I think, at the end. Off the Astral himself, he might have been able to blink away, and he instead like opted to turn around and throw his ulti. The fight just didn't go down under comfortable circumstances for TNC. I feel like they just felt pressured to do things that they hadn't prepared to do in advance because the... It's funny because the Venge swaps them in all of a sudden and they're surprised and they panic and they have to react. And even though they deal with the Venge itself, the decisions that come after that just seem kind of panicked.
The momentum has definitely shifted. Fnatic with his lone druid, these items. Hyperstone on his bear, plate mail on his hero, gyrocopter. Yeah, he's got a lot of stats behind him. Dire's courier drops is that.
Kray was sitting on the cliff here, I'm not sure why.
Scouting Roshan, I guess.
Yeah.
scramble here for TN to push out these lanes though, and maybe try and stop Fnatic from pushing up the high ground. 3-4-3 has been caught off guard, but still just jump forward there with the call down. But Teemi, BKBs, the instant the snare comes out, the roots from the lone druid as they use drop very, very low, but not quite finished off. So the final illusion hit comes out all over on the side. Last on the DJ, they've caught out the Nyx assassin. No caravan, the death pull down, he's actually taken out. The Nyx is gone, but Sam H falls up to the low ground. Net and Ohio still standing like kings of the hill on top of this ramp until Raven wants to usurp the crown. He has everything. He's got his BKB. The Savage Roar means nothing, and Ohio just being right clicked into oblivion. But in comes mid one again with the damage output. While Sam H burns through Ohio, but the lone druid still bubbling through with a Spirit Bear. And see, he caught Captain Doom. James can't. I'll dig down, but where's the puck? Jumps away. Mid one keeps himself alive, but TNC, they are now of their own fate. Roshan's alive, but they don't have the best taking lineup without the OD alive.
Anyhow, I've spent so much time in this series talking about the OD when it uses the ulti, because I think in that fight, if he hit one more time before he ulti'd, I think it would have been much, much better. I think the lone druid might have even popped at that point. It wasn't quite as good. But the decision TNC made there, I think they're almost willing to let their OD die. They realized the other heroes couldn't tank the gyrocopter BKB. They couldn't be in it. So OD just goes in with its BKB and inevitably ends up dying, but everyone else can come back in once both the BKBs are finished and ultimately win the fights as a result.
Well, a difficult game here for mid one on this part. You know, he's getting good cant initiations. It's rare that we see him able to be the ones on the front lines, and 4-3, that's like the third time in a row really he's been really far up, not being in a position to defend from swap, and he's just been killed for nothing really in return.
Yeah, and it's a bit different to, I was comparing in my head when it happened there, like to last game, we're saying AU when he was dying on the bench, a lot of the time it just felt he's meant to be the furthest out, he tanks the smoke gank or something. That's, it feels like all these deaths from 3-3 are not exactly the same, especially in a game where he has good reason to not want to be on the front lines because he can counter the map.
Roshan's falling quickly, but is it falling enough? Three-handed wave of terror skipping it across, but Sam H instant initiates onto Metal Spirit, drags him up onto the high ground, but DJ there's jump forward in, sort of picked up by the Emperor, and they're gonna try and fly through this into the pit, they take down the Witch Doctor. DJ still stands his ground, but hobbled into oblivion by Astral. Jump to the OD. Mid one. Raven is just straight up screwed over in the pit. Teehee was the one that got the Aegis. Crappy, messy fight all around there. That's it. The ones that feel the happiest with this. Again, killing the OD, forcing the buyback from the Witch Doctor. Yeah, the map again.
Puts is just a good pick for Fnatic to fight, especially when OD doesn't have ulti and they knew that. Just, I think the Lich also didn't have ulti. I think they both didn't have ulti at the start, unless Lich used this right at the beginning. I might be wrong about that, but I didn't see it. And okay, this is going to be Witch Doctor getting forced. He's got Glimmer Cave, they don't actually have Reveal, so he's fine. Yeah, the Gyrocopter's BKB is just doing so much fantastic work this game. TNC just really lack ways to deal with his BKB.
He still has the high ground defense capability here of his Ember Spirit, and just slamming out his slight fit for mid one. Up with DJ to get the start as well. Fall down more than current than anything. Gee, he's gonna burn through the Aegis here. Answers that is death ward. Don't know if he got stunned up or something like that, but now the front line Sam H tries to get the blink force there with the lasso now onto net. The charge being caught, we're getting tackled back on Sam H, so he can't move himself away with Raven. Ah, damage output. Yeah, too strong. We have to deal with. No way just left, he's on top in the demonstrate. Glimmer Cape through, plus a lot of fists to get the chase down onto 3-4-3 to cleave it there. But with his Anis Eclipse, not really landing onto anyone, just more of a throw to see what happens kind of thing for Raven. The lone druid Spirit Bear, now finally Savage Roar's back, but mid one on the high ground. The kill, picks the gem. With the double balls now as Raven.
Oh, he's chasing.
What, Nyx passing. Mana burn. The Carapace and the stun, and mid one maybe could have been able to jump himself back into this one. DJ still alive, double damage forward, TV secures and clears. Oh, keep track of who's winning these fights though. 22-27, that's a TNC favorite engagement overall. They're fighting on their turf again, so they don't get a tier 2, they don't get a tier 1. TV's gonna try and TP top into this. Lone Druid's still farming.
Still feel like in what's causing trouble to TNT right now is that they're forced to struggle against both the Lone Druid and the Gyro. Like, they can't deal with either of them that easily. They've had this plan where they Astral the Spirit Bear quite a lot, but even when you do that, that means you don't have the option to Astral yourself. Suddenly you can be focused, you can't Astral the teammate that gets caught. So it's not the best plan. A plan. It's just the damage output. Gyrocopter, when he's in BKB, they struggle to... They kind of have to run from him, and there's also the Lone Druid. And if they had a more reasonable answer to at least one of those things, like where they kill Ness eventually, that's because the fight lasts so long. It's after his BKB. It's in like the second part of the fight. And in that sense, it's really good that he's finally getting to damage. His progression kind of like was, you know, it went all the long way around. It was a blink, was a BKB, and now he's getting to the crits, and that'll help to deal some damage through the Jara's BKB.
Look at all these gems that Fnatic have. Two gems in the fountain, there's one still on the puck, collecting all the little green orbs as possibly can. Now, Witch Doctor, lethal lens over the Aghanim Scepter, I guess he's farming up that amazingly well over on Kuku. Level 16 though, so he will have powerful Witch Doctor Death Ward getting thrown out.
That long range paralyzing cast, which is like, seen the power of that once already in this game, if you catch the right situation.
You're just trying to self out of harm's reach here up on the top lane, cutting through trees and clearing through creep waves. Fnatic that are all grouped down on the bottom lane.
Raven for Lincolns. I saw ultimate orb earlier, I thought he was gonna go for the Hex, but he's gone for the Lincolns, which definitely will help him stay alive, but at the same time I feel like there's 4 second cooldown mana burn, it's not that difficult to just Lincolns.
Weird one, huh? Like, mana burn's annoying, I guess. Taking out the first one of them, or maybe the swap, but...
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
See, though? Solves up after waves. I don't know if Fnatic will give them the choice, though. Ward up on this high ground, obviously, going to be good at scouting out any smokes that happen towards the lane, but... still... this mid-rat. And the lift is not available here, so the Spirit could potentially just walk up and start wailing away at it, but the fingers come out and they say, no. Everyone at top still standing. Do not give TNC anything here. Back yourselves up, we'll regroup and fight in a little bit. No reason to go commit too heavily for this, as long as we can just push in, continue farming ourselves and get into these bigger items, like a Hex on Puck, something along those lines, while the Lurid building a BKB for his bear. You're just going to be lacking. OD, sure enough, they've got damage output and they've got BKB. Wrap around, I think enough, though. 3-4-3 on the court. The Vengeful Spirit is taking over the game. Net, the cooldown is decent on their head. But in comes the Sleight of Fist and Ember Spirit. He's found his target. He wants to kill off Net. Zero chain down onto the both of them, and this Dark Ops is wiped out of them. The bloody game. Ohio cannot escape from this OD, even with mid one jumping in to try and save you. All you need is one entangle. Try and entangle that Outworld Devourer, but QQ's here to try and save his buddy. Cask is ready in a second, and the Spirit Bear. Hey, moon out onto the OD. Ohio. Apparently, he was tanky enough to be alive through it. He's back into action.
I actually think Raven needed maybe one or two more hits, and he could have dropped the hammer and completely burst Ohio down. That's what he was hoping for, I think, but just gets stopped in his tracks. A little bit short.
Here was the mid one Puck just jumping in and causing a little bit of havoc there, but see, they killed the Gyrocopter and now high ground defense is all down to this Puck and Lone Druid at this point. Tier 2. Nicely secured here. The swap, who have they got? They've caught out the Batrider, but it's an Astral from Raven saving his teammate and they've killed off 3-4-3. Way too far forward and aggressive with the swap, and Sam Angel looked like he might be an easy kill, but great reaction from Raven. Four.
That's good ulti again. They could get someone at the battle ulti here, and all of a sudden it could be a Rax situation.
Maybe. The resummon?
Yeah.
The Remnant.
To go back as well, and that's for me, it's a positive sign. Oh, AU's ports and might just die here, I think. Yeah, I don't think he gets out alive. For me, it's a positive sign because both teams making these decisions at the enemy team's doorstep. Maybe we should go back and play it safe. And again, I think it's the kind of decision that Fnatic gets right more often than TNC. So that TNT are feeling comfortable to compose longer, more drawn out game is probably a positive sign for them.
Glenn's on your ballad and out. Running to ragged a little bit with his movements, but Beaky finally done for the Spirit Bear, gives them the chance to bear up at the high ground and not care about Astral Orb. Chains out from his Ember Spirit. Ohio definitely does have to be the carry in this game.
The Beaky Bear is here at the moment. You gotta assume he moves it to Spirit Bear, right? That's...
Yeah. I assume so.
This is, and the Odie's been astraling the Spirit Bear in every fight, and I think that's a lot. It's actually, I mean, I was talking about how it does weaken the Odie a bit, not having the Astral available, but obviously it's still doing a lot of work. Like, that's like 20,000 net worth just turned off for 4 seconds every time he astrals. But I think that's what the BKB is about, but Ohio just holding on to the item on his hero for now.
Oh.
Is it just to, like, stop Odie from orbing you? Maybe?
Really not sure.
That is a way you can die. Like, just 5 or 6 orbs and then ulti and suddenly Odie's dismode him. I don't know. I still think it moved. I'm waiting for the fight to see if he actually BKB's his hero.
It's an 11-7 second. Smoke timing could be perfect for Fastek. Fast one. He's gonna walk in just as he comes back up. Look at that. Very fortunate here, but TNC won away so easily. Empty, all alone, spotted out the swap back, but that was very interesting. Swap back, Nyx jumped forward, cross. Guys, nobody get hurt.
That was, he didn't even have a remnant, right? That was just a really quick blink.
Yeah.
No, he doesn't have a remnant. He didn't use the remnant.
Blink. Sean's not going to touch just here.
Very stuff.
The knowledge that observer ward was up and now they get rid of it. Vision in this area now up on its high ground, watching around towards the Roche pit. HGL scouts in with sticky napalm, there's no one in there. So, make the mistake of trying to take down Roche down again because last time it definitely count for them.
It's gone a pure tanky build for Skadi now. I mean, it's a very defensive tanky build on Gyrocopter, and I guess the concern is you don't want to get, like, burst down by crits on Ember Spirits or something like that. But it does come at the cost of him having less damage output than he'd have if you went for MKB or Butterfly.
Team's very timid in their movements. Like, both teams know that this Roshan is incredibly important with Aegis and Cheese. One wants to give it up, but also neither one wants to try and split push heavily. TNC have the better opportunity for the Ember Spirit. Keep himself up top, then rim back down towards the lane. He's actually been very good, see, he's starting to hide his remnants as well away from the Nyx Assassin, because that's something that Fnatic have been trying to abuse the past 10-15 minutes. So, looking for like the swap initiation, then camp someone on top of a remnant just to try and kill him off as he returns to it. Like you said with Ascardi, taking himself up.
Does he finally get the last tier 1, or gonna be chased away by the Spirit Bear?
Still alive. Give up on the dreams of Roshan. This wave out. But now, anyway, forcing TNC to get back into their base. He's really struggling with his Spirit Bear, huh?
This ward on the cliff here outside Rush is so interesting because it's like each time the one team runs past it, they kill the enemy ward and put their own. It's just like whoever's possession of that area of the map at that point in time has the vision as well.
Comes down to half HP, and with the Jarkov having a DD and helping out now significantly faster. They can't EJ, BKB out, Teehee in the clear up Nyx Assassin, Roshan though is dead, Aegis. They caught the Gyrocopter, it took a little while for that one to go, but the cheese is still on the deck. Picked up by Ohio, is over to the side. Fuck, but mid one blinks himself away, the Hex is there as well. The fuck. Escape from this, and looks like he's got another orb as well as the Yule Scepter, but still the silence just in time. Jumps into the trees, hiding himself away, but the slight change. About to catch him. Yule Scepter. Gonna be able to save him.
Blinks
north. Oh my god, orb south. He's gonna jump to it, fakes it out. still hiding in the tree. He's gonna get found. There's no escape anymore, really. Come on now. The amount of dancing around. Dear lord.
Much fun was had, and it'll probably still go down as being worth it to Fnatic, I think. I think just about worth it. Go up for the next attack and get the Aegis and get off with it, as well as the cheese. Because it's not like TNT are gonna get anything off that right now. Those heroes will be respawned by the time it might have to happen, and then they'll have 5v5 with the Aegis and cheese.
He just picked up an ultimate orb of his own. Don't know if that's gonna be a Lincoln Sphere or a Skadi for him.
I've seen Raven putting his Lincolns on him quite a lot.
Yeah.
So.
Chosen. Well, Annaburn is a wonderful thing from Jay. Druid though getting stacked up. Did you see? He used his BKB on a hero, right?
I think so, yeah. I think he did.
Like he swapped it.
I think it was just when they were rushing. I don't think like it ended up doing anything. It was just like in case someone jumps in. But I guess it's got to be then about the threat of the OD. I think OD is quite a good way to kill a Lone Druid really quickly. I think there was a fight at mid where I was saying that... But you were saying that Ojai was going to go down and he nearly did and then he didn't. I really think that that was the situation where maybe one more hit from OD would have just been like 5 hits from 4 HP plus the ulti and then he dies. So could explain keeping the BKB on his hero.
Radiant structures are fortified.
That's it.
Radiant's bottom tower.
Oh, hungry to catch someone. Samage though, he is equally aggressive, jumping forward onto mid one. The puck. Bone silence coming out onto Samage. Green ball onto three as well. The actual self onto the OD, but there's no death ward, there's no little, but the bunch shredded to Samage, taking out the game as well. The BKB on the barrel does nothing. T and Raven, they're both destroyed under the power here of Fnatic, only losing DJ. Well, 4 drop from TNC. Their positioning. Really caught off balance by the smoke from Fnatic coming in from the north.
Yeah, and DJ managed to stay alive quite a while, forced TNT to commit quite a lot. But creeps are busy raxing mid, and now it's Fnatic's turn to hold DC. I believe it happened to TNT in the first game.
Five Fnatic. All gone. They've left the LAN cafe to get some Rocky Canai. Tarek? What time is it? It's dinner time now. Gem. See. Well, I felt that they were in the lead and maybe not metric wise, maybe not, you know, net worth wise in the lead, but I felt they were in the lead draft wise and play wise for a good portion of this game. Now all of a sudden it feels like that one move. Why are you all alive? What? It just feels like that with that one move down a bottom lane, given a lot back to Fnatic, because it gives them the opportunity to fly back, and that swings the entire momentum into Fnatic's favor pretty massively.
Yeah. Maybe when he rejoined, he couldn't see the death timers or something. it's like, didn't we just kill all of you? By the way, you know these teams are set to play, I think I said before, they've meant to play best of five right after this. This is like, this has been a pretty long and thrilling best of three series so far. And I don't know if they're going to be given a break, because that best of five is scheduled to originally at least to start in 10 minutes from now. It's going to be a long day for these teams.
Wow. One, an arduous journey for them. Very well matched, honestly. Fnatic though. Ready to push high ground again. There's a lift here for TNC as well as Ember Spirit with Lich.
Dire's middle barracks has fallen.
Defend, but they lost their range racks to creeps as they were pushing in, and that kind of triggered the buyback coming out. Lone Druid. There forward. Had the pause, but. Oh yeah, they do see everyone alive. Bug.
What an awkward situation. The admins here, that's actually very helpful. Yeah, they need to see when they're respawning.
That's an X bug. Well. Ohio, what's the verdict? Can you see the respawn timers? quiet, very calm.
I think the admin has to manually, like, count down all of the timers.
How? Three at once? Just
keep spamming, yeah. 49, 48, 39, 48, 47,
38. Oh my god, that would be awful. I mean, at least they're all close to each other, right? You could just say, like, 48, 48, and 39. So, like, OD and Witch Doctor are gonna respawn at the same time, and Batrider's 10 seconds faster.
Yeah, I definitely think at very least they can be told.
Nice.
Right. Very sporting.
Right, we're ready to go again. So, Char, you're gonna take down the timers there. Well, it doesn't matter about the Batrider when he buys back like that, right? The timer no longer exists. OD, 41 seconds. Witch Doctor, 39. Bellarax, not gonna get killed off just yet. Spirit Bear. Opportunity to run himself forward, but it's net up on the high ground. Ascardi and the Aegis available, and he is very difficult to kill off. And is that a resummon? Were there cheese under the bear? Oh, still dragged back, net caught out now behind the tier 4s. The Gyrocop is taken all the way back to his doom, but he's still got Aegis and BKB. Wonder if 343 body out of this one with the BKB forward. He's actually chained up, so he can't do that. But net just turns and fights up against Raven and Teehee, but the BKB is under that guise of magic immunity. That much damage, BKB from TE just stopped aggressively, and now it's like Raven is here with the Eclipse ready. He wants to crack as much damage as he can, and he will take down two. Ohio BKB's himself, but the Dream Call falls in mid one, catches out a couple. TQ and Raven both trapped in, the snap is there as well. The OD trapped in, and TK just forward with that mana burn. He's done a ton of damage back to that wall devourer, but Sam H is still BKB'd up, looking for the Firefly, and Sticky Nabok stacked up as well. Death Ward is down. QQ, the help of TE. Kill off of Ohio, they just need that jump. It's going to be the cast that bounces back, but not falls onto Ohio. The mid one hex is onto TE. The Lincoln Sphere was there, but it's not going to be enough. The Glimmercade is down, and Ohio is burning through. Mid one, is he the last one alive? Nyx Assassin is still somewhere, but DJ, he's on a full retreat. Reverse mode. Assassin bails out of that one. They lose their melee racks. TNC, they kind of hold.
This is going to be a tension in the game from Fnatic for the rest of the game. The second time I noticed it, it happened once much earlier in the game when Jarrah had a long BKB, but now he has a 5-second BKB. It's much more pressure because if he uses the BKB and doesn't, and TNC is all alive, still has all their spells, and the BKB ends, it's actually really dangerous for Fnatic. I feel like every single time TNC are going to go in, they're going to be like, okay, Jarrah used BKB, we're all alive, we have everything, time to charge forward and go nuts.
Buyback from mid one, and now a hex from the Glimmercape, and a secondary Lincoln's is here for Teehee. Ember Spirit, he wants to jump aggressively. Jay still holding his ground though with stuns and carapace. Mid one, this buyback has to pay off with his high ground defense. NC. The offensive. There's no lone druid spirit bear. Buyback on him is available, but not really necessary at this point because. See, don't commit. Get what they want. A little bit of pressure, a buyback out, or retreat themselves away.
Right, what? I mean, at this stage in the game, with the Ember Spirit, we always ask the question, does he go rapier? What does he go? He's got a lot of gold. What's the progression here?
Does he swap out?
It seems like all these pieces are quite important to him. Like, would he drop the blink? I mean, if he really thinks the BKB and the Lincoln is that important to him, usually the blink is vital. But... I don't know, does he drop his travels? Maybe he drops his travels if he wants the rapier.
You have to have the travels on the courier. Have them near you. Batrider. Jay. Carapace to start things off. After the swap as well. Batrider initiation not coming to anything as that drift squad drops two of them. Aegis forced himself into an awkward situation, but still, the BKBs are out for Fnatic, and this might be the chance for the OD to turn a fight, but AU's keeping himself away while Teehee will retreat as well. Flight chain jump forward, orbit there as well, but the Lincoln's into the hex, they've caught him out, Teehee's now pretty much dead, but the Glimmercase from QQ keeps him alive a little bit longer, BKB pops as well, fly back, he can try and ramp himself forward, but it's on cooldown. 3 seconds, he'll blink himself away. And with that perfect hex initiation for mid one. Oh, cast Teehee's Ember Spirit.
He kind of remnanted into the orb there. Really nice idea. It's gonna be difficult for Batrider to catch someone out of out of the range of Vantage Warp would be like pushing the enemy base. I feel like that was the ambitious beginning of the whole thing to start with.
Flyback. OD bat. Glitch. Time. Matter. There, but it's on low HP, no resumpter. Ohio will TP. No, he will not, because Kask is an annoying bastard of a spell. Oh, it was doing there. He tried to TP the bear back to heal it up, then resummon it, return it to himself, but it doesn't work out, thanks to the doctor.
Well, maybe we start looking toward the rush pit again, because it is getting to that time. And I'm still. Oh, there's the damage now, Gyrocopter, so it's going to become even more vital for Fnatic to have the Gyro in the right position and get that value out of the hero during the BKB. Inside the BKB, it's still going to have problems, but inside the BKB, he actually they're really going to struggle.
Moon Shard on your Outworld Devourer now, but it's always about sticking on a target. You know, you've got no hexes, no real good instant disable. Samich has to have a good Blink Lasso. Catch out someone important, make this worthwhile and deals damage, because you have damage dealers here for TNC. Having damage and outputting damage are two very different concepts. You need stuns to be able to output damage, and that's something the Fnatic have tons of. You know, they've got Hex, they've got Dream Coil, they've got Nyxis Assassin with a bunch, and they've also got damage from the Gyro and the Lone Druid, like you're saying. But TNC, they kind of rely on a cast, they rely on, you know, Astral taking someone out of the fight, they rely on Chaos to deal their damage. Chain Frost, yep. Sleight of Fist, with all this nonsense being thrown on top of teamfights and forcing Fnatic to make the errors in teamfights where they get split up and forced into situations where they're like 1 versus 3. If the fight is clean and Fnatic have the initiation, they cancel out the Batrider and everything is executed well from both teams and this chaos isn't available, Fnatic are going to come out on top.
He, by the way, bought a Moonshot and ate it. Doesn't really do much in Ember Spirit, but I guess delays the decision further of if he's going to replace one of these items, because he clearly is very attached to all of them right now.
A Lincoln's placed on him as well, so double Lincoln's. Yeah, 4CE. Tier 3, he wants it. Illusion popped out for the Master Style. Okay, just to back himself away. Mid one, he's still waiting for this initiation. TNC, they've spread themselves out so well here that there's no good jump in, there's no Dream Coil targets. Really to hex up either. Standoff where TNC are always going to be the ones that come off. Close for where?
Net needs to just watch his HP, that's the thing. He knows if he uses the BKB too early, they can lose the fight for it, but if he doesn't have lifesteal, he doesn't have any way to make his HP go up. They don't even have heal for him. Like, there's no urn, there's no mech. So, if he's going to siege and they're going to slowly spam him down, all of a sudden there could be that point where TNT can come in.
Oh, they've got Ohio, the swap back goes 3-4-3, perfectly on the mark. And Sam H tried. Again, they just cannot get this initiation, and that means they cannot get that damage done. So it's going to come down to the jump in for mid one. Dreamcall is there on the Raven, but on the back end, he draws a spam of blood, but gets a change to the Ohio. The Chain Cross is there as well. Net bounces back onto the Baron, back onto the Lone Druid. But on the front lines, let's take a look at DJ up there, dealing with the OD 1 versus 2. TE finally clears up the Spirit Bear. Fnatic. Going to lose mid one. And it's on him, but they'll blink out for face shift. 4-3 might be losing his life again as the sacrificial lamb, but it's a jump forward. Hee hungry, angry, 3-4-3, slams into grandma, Raven jumps forward now to mid one as well, the Astral Zed is probably going to clear him up! Fuck!
Raven could chase,
yeah,
still no BKB
on Jaro. No BKB on Jaro, no BKB on Ohio, there's no life left on DJ, and there's no life left on Fnatic. They clear up the spirit though. Rise back into things to try and clear up net, but up on the front, Lone Druid. Chase this one down. They've got a blink in 5. Bear, bear. Resummon. Yeah, 70 seconds of this one taken out, they'll change it up, look at that damage. Bear does not last long under the Astral Orbs.
I think what happens is, it looks kind of good for Fnatic. I was talking so much about how if Jara wears BKB, that's a big deal. It's also quite big if TNC wears their BKBs. And the Puck and the Nyx kind of jump forward and get the OD and the Ember Spirit to use their BKBs. The bat had already BKB'd, I think, at the beginning with the attempted initiation. So it looked good to me. I was like, Huck's gone into the back end, so is Nyx, and they've just forced the OD to do nothing. Especially the Lone Druid and the Gyro don't have the mobility, so to kill those heroes doesn't help to just force their BKBs. And I think, tell me if you disagree, I think that if both teams use all their BKBs, that actually favors TNC.
I agree. Like
So it's not as big of a deal. If all you're going to achieve is force their BKBs while your BKBs are forcing the other side of the fight, like, then suddenly everyone realizes, hey, nobody's got BKB left, and it's TNC who decide time to chase.
Apparently OD cannot attack. I was looking at him and I'm wondering, is he fully in the Roche pit?
Oh.
This is a guaranteed rush, right? This, I don't think there's anything to be done about this. Even if Gyro and Kuk were to buy, Kuk can't buy back, but even if Gyro were to buy back, there's no way to get you. Yeah, so who takes what?
I was going to ask OD. You the question. You can answer this one.
Okay. Odie's gonna drop the drum and tell it and pick up the Aegis, and there's no way that Ember Spirit takes anything if he's not willing to. If, you know, if he's buying Moonshards, he's not dropping any of those items for Aegis or Cheese. I think he'd be quite surprised. Although did just use buyback, so cancel everything I just said. He's gonna fight. What's he gonna drop? I don't know, but he's probably gonna take the Aegis. Just walk back.
When you probably drop the Blink right for Aegis and give Cheese to Raven. Would have been nice to have Batrider having Cheese, I think, but yeah, drop the Blink, pick up Aegis. At least drop that little bit of leeway, see he and out will Devourer not losing his drum.
No, he just wanted to sell him, which will bring him the Cheese. That's the job of the Lich. Bring me my Cheese. Though, no, Raven actually just wants to build a Hex and hold the Cheese for now.
He is swap. Blink for BKB, so he doesn't have a BKB anymore.
I guess why you have the Aegis. I mean, it's, yeah, the Blink is maneuverability and the BKB survivability, and Aegis is survivability more than maneuverability. So if you want to have some of each, kind of makes sense, but may just lose the Aegis right now.
Surely. And a burn, it's a lot of damage with that Hex as well, but still alive. Now Remnant and TP back to base, heal up and then return to the fight again. Four staff to secure that turn to fountain.
Lundra just buy a new BKB. I'm sure I saw one on the side of the screen.
Yes, got one on his bed.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Itch, and that one actually has still 10 seconds, right? It's unit dependent, I think. So
There's actually something to do with Spirit Bear, and you can have permanent 10 stack EKB on your Spirit Bear.
Yeah, but let's not explain how.
I mean, it's a well-documented... Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's not explained. I don't know if it's been done in competitive, but... A little bit annoying that it exists that way. Because it even has the marker, like, visually it says it's going down in duration, but the actual... ...character duration still stays in 10 seconds. Blink back from Teehee, I mean that was barely on time. We saw DJ trying to get in there with a stun after Homing Missile landed.
Such a rare thing to see, but Teehee is putting that Moonshot to work on Ember Spirit. I mean, he's Ember Spirit standing and right-clicking a building. Like, how often do you see that?
Very rarely. Now the focus orb, Blink and pops, look at all that. The half HP already, but healed up with Restoration and the Urn, and Teehee just goes back up onto high ground and tunnels into the tier 3, looking for a swap onto someone, but they can't use it aggressively really here unless they secure that kill 100% done. Landing. Sam H is always looking for that initiation, but he also has to forward onto the Raven, maybe trying to force the BKB out here. Fnatic poking and prodding, looking for that cheeky little move forward, but it's TNC. I have to actually retreat. Oh, good, a two-man stun there, fall down as well, but Ohio blinks forward aggressively, looking for AU and QQ, but they're still alive. Net splashing down his damage with the Black Cannon, but the cheese isn't there for the Raven OD. And four down with no buybacks from TNC. Ember Spirit's the only one left alive, and he has to retreat back up to the top lane to defend against the creeps. The game might just end.
Yeah, I actually wanted to save before the fight, but it was too tense. It might be a mistake, although any buy down for Hex there. I think you got it. Does he He had the time, right? Yeah, his buyback had cooled down, so I think he's just gotta save it there. It's far too possible for him to die. His BKB doesn't make him invincible in this game. And I think that that's gotta, like, that got to be a decision that they regret at this point in time, that OD can't buy back. Like, it's not worth it, it didn't win them the fight.
They have to systematically go from lane to lane, I think. One rack down, they might even look for TD. Hexed up, demolished. Aegis is gone. We have a remnant. He doesn't. There's nothing out there. He might have flicked some way to see. There's a blade instantly there now. No buyback for him and TMC. 2 minutes without your Ember Spirit and no heroes left standing. The tier 4s are kind of an anticlimactic ending here to this series. But Fnatic, they're going to take it.
This is, I think, what we've come to expect from this matchup, honestly. It's unfortunate, and it's where TNT will grow as a team in this regard is exactly from getting to land. There's an irony here when they, like, fail to qualify for land by losing to Fnatic. But it's this stage of the game, these late game big decisions. Who buys which item? What do you replace with what? Where do we stand? Should we save buyback? Should we get the item? Those things are very difficult. They're very, very, very difficult. It comes with a lot of time and experience and top level play. And Fnatic, I just think, have TNT's number in that regard, and it's where I've seen them time and time again.
But Fnatic moves themselves through to the grand final, which is the best of